Okay, so today I'm going to talk about the cardiac catheterizations. Today, mostly, I will talk about normal hemodynamics. So, because you are going to do the cath lab rotation, I think it's important to understand some basic numbers and some ideas. So when you rotate cardiac catheterization laboratory, usually people more pay attention to the angiography, such as coronary angiography or the techniques, but you also have to think about the cardiac hemodynamics. So when you order the cardiac catheterization, you order right or left heart cath. But in more specific terminology, actually, the catheterization means when you insert a catheter to the heart, that is considered catheterization. So if you order left heart cath, it's actually not include coronary angiography. So the CPT code are actually different. So technically, if you want the cath people do coronary angiography, you have to order coronary angiography. That's different order. But most of the people just use in mixed fashion, like catheterization or angiography. So whenever you insert a catheter to the heart, it's considered cardiac catheterization, even though you don't do angio. So that's important to understand. And so when you have any questions or anything, you can just ask me anytime. Okay? And usually when we do cardiac cath, as you know, we do left heart cath or right heart cath. Left heart cath, we have to insert catheter into the arterial system. And right heart cath, you have to insert a catheter to the venous system. Sometimes you can go left to right inside of the heart through the septum puncture. But most of the time, for the left heart cath, you have to puncture artery. So traditionally, we use the femoral artery. But most of the time these days, we use radial artery for the cardiac cath. So radial artery, as you know, is a little more convenient for the patient. For the right heart cath, you use mostly in the past femoral artery. Sorry, femoral veins. But these days in our laboratory, we actually for elective cases, we use arm veins. So there are several veins you can use in the arm. What veins do you use for the right heart cath? Anybody can tell?
The antecubital vein like you have there, the other
Yes.
vein, the
Yeah.
tibial vein. So,
Brachial.
right. So for the veins access in the arm, there are superficial veins and deep veins. We usually don't use a deep vein, which is a brachial vein. The brachial vein is passing side by side brachial artery. There are two brachial veins and one brachial artery. But we usually put the venous access in the either cephalic vein or basilic vein or antecubital veins. Those three are mostly used superficial veins. So most of the time the nurse can put the IV line and then we can replace the IV line to the sheath. Sometimes you have to use ultrasound inside the laboratory when there is a difficulty to access the superficial veins. So 95% you can actually do the right heart cath with the superficial arm veins. But sometimes there's some difficulty to advance Caterer, then you probably have to use the brachial vein. But brachial vein access sometimes end up with more bleeding complications. So brachial vein should be accessed only with ultrasound because there is a artery beside. So there's risk of puncture to the artery. And if you don't compress after puncture the brachial artery, there is a significant bleeding. And most of the time it's not observed, but at the end of the procedure, the patient ends up with hematoma in the elbow. So it's important to access brachial vein if you have to use your arm. If you don't want to go to the groin access, then ultrasound technique is very important. And probably the technical things we will discuss probably separately. But for the femoral artery and radial artery puncture, usually in the past we just did with a manual technique. But for femoral artery puncture, in these days, the ultrasound is also very widely used, and you can learn the technique during cath rotation. For the radial artery puncture, you usually do without ultrasound, but if any difficulties and you still have to use radial artery, you can use ultrasound as well. And then, as I said, sometimes you have to use a septal puncture to the rectal cath. As you see in this picture, this is actually the left ventricular LV pressure, and this is the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure. This one, the red one. And in diastole, there is the pressure gradient, so it looks like a significant mitral stenosis. But when the LA pressure directly measured, the pressure actually is less than this one. So there could be some discrepancy. Which condition you can see this discrepancy?
Pulmonary hypertension.
Yeah, usually it's a condition that has lung problems, like a very advanced COPD or pulmonary embolization or chronic thromboembolic pulmonary hypertension. There is a vascular damage there, so there is no direct communication. So sometimes, if you have to do meticulous measurement for mitral valve stenosis, you have to actually do septal puncture to directly measure LA and LV pressure with two catheters. And we have to remember, firstly, I think you already have done cardiac rotation, so you probably will know, but you have to be able to recognize the normal pressure waveforms, the aorta, LV, pulmonary artery, and the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure. So this is a very basic, but you have to remember the number, normal numbers. So other thing you have to think about is when you measure the femoral artery and like aorta artery, aortic root pressure together, it's not always the same. It's actually femoral artery pressure is a little peak systolic pressure a little higher and little delayed because of the summation effect of the reflected waves within the artery system. So in general, there's about less than 20 millimeter mercury overshoot of the femoral pressure relative to the central aortic pressure. So just remember that this one femoral artery and this one is aortic root pressure. So this is delayed and higher. Sometimes In the past, actually, for aortic valve stenosis, some people used pressure gradient from side branch of the femoral artery from the sheath, and then LV pressure with. So in this case, aortic pressure gradient may be not correct because there's a significant, at least significant difference. So usually for meticulous measurement of the aortic stenosis, we have to use the one catheter with dual lumen pressure tracing, which is a Langston catheter. This is better and more correct. Do you have any questions here?
No, Dr. Lee, I was going to ask if you can change your view to a slideshow view so that we'll have full screen.
Oh, okay.
Thank you.
Welcome. Okay. So, in such a case, we use two catheter together to measure two or more chamber pressure simultaneously. So, most common condition that you have to measure, use two catheter together is aortic valve stenosis. And as you see here, this wedge pressure and LV pressure measured together. So, such as mitral stenosis, we have to measure this LV pressure. So, one catheter is in the LV, and the other catheter, the right heart catheter, is in the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure position from the right heart cath. So, to make these waveforms, we have to do right and left heart catheter together inserted in the heart. One is in the wedge pressure position, the other one is LV position. Sometimes also, when you do constrictive pericarditis evaluation, you have to do simultaneous tracing like this one, or sometimes you have to do LV-IV tracing. One catheter is in the RV, one catheter in the LV, and you have to simultaneous trace. So the aortic stenosis, mitral stenosis, constrictive pericarditis, those conditions require two catheter techniques. So you need to prepare two transducers from the beginning. And then depending on what condition the referring physician wants you to check, you have to prepare, you have to remind yourself what kind of thing you have to do during the catheterization. Otherwise, you can miss the procedure after finishing the procedure. So, for example, if the indication of a cardiac cath was to evaluate aortic valve stenosis, you have to prepare two transducer and Langston catheters. You have to certainly measure critical numbers by the catheterization to fulfill the referring physician's indication. For example, the patient is referred for mitral valve stenosis. You have to do right heart, left heart cath together, and then try to measure the mitral valve gradient, such as so pre-procedure planning is important for cardiac catheterization, because if you just routinely do, you can re forget the important step. Do you have any questions? Okay, so first I'm going to talk right atrial pressure. So how do you measure right atrial pressure? So you have to insert the catheter from the vein, either antecubital or superficial arm veins, or from the femoral vein to the RA. So this RA pressure is usually first pressure that we measure for the right heart catheterization. So you also all know that ACXVY, the waveforms. This is important to recognize normal wave shape And then also important to recognize abnormal ACXVY wave shapes. So, and also it's important to remember the normal pressure. What's normal RA pressure?
0 to 5.
Yes. So usually the between 1 to 8 is normal. So mean as a mean arterial pressure. So if the RA catheter, I mean the catheter is the RA and the pressure is 12, then means it's not normal. So the RA pressure is increased. So those small things is important to recognize actually. For example, the patient refer for the right heart cath, and patient has a lot of leg swellings, and then you measured RA pressure is high, like 14, then that's the probably cause of the leg swellings. The RA pressure is elevated. The patient may have also IV or PA pressure elevation. So that's why patient may have leg swelling. So those abnormal number is important to be recognized and addressed after cardiac catheterization. So you cannot just miss numbers. You just have to think about if the number is not normal, why it's not normal, if the abnormal number is related with the patient condition. So every small detail is important to recognize. And then as you have to just remember this one, the A wave actually is developed by the atrial systole. So it's immediately following the P wave. So you just memorize A wave, the atrial contraction. And then V wave is made by the ventricular contraction. And the X wave is atrial diastolic. And V wave is ventricular diastolic. So keep in mind this ACXVY. And then in certain cardiac condition, this shape can be changed. For example, if there is any absence of V-wave, what do you have to think about? So, for example, this is ACXVY, but Y-wave is flat like this, and then it just go to A, no A Y-wave, then what condition is this?
Atrial fibrillation.
No, there's other more important condition.
Right heart failure?
No, absence V wave is very important to remember. It's usually a key sign of the cardiac temperate. Cardiac temperate. They actually ask you this question every day, every time for cardiac cardiology board actually. Absence V wave is cardiac temperate. And accentuation of V wave is what condition?
Severe TR.
Sorry, not V wave. That's a severe TR or MR. How about accentuation of Y wave?
Restrictive cardiomyopathy.
Restrictive pericarditis.
Accentuation Y descent, constrictive pericarditis, and absence of Y descent, pericardial temperate. Those things specifically you have to memorize it, because the board ask those questions. But the important thing, you have to memorize the normal number and normal waveforms. Usually two positive deflection, A wave, actually three, AC and V, and then two negative deflection, X and Y. Those are important to remember. And the V wave usually slightly higher in normal condition than X wave. So as you can see here, LA pressure usually always higher than the RA pressure. Waveforms usually similar. And then if you keep pushing the catheter to the ventricle, so depending on which axis do you use actually, right ventricular catheterization techniques are different actually. If you go from neck, And the catheter is already angled like a scoop. So if you float the balloon, usually it reaches the RA naturally. And then if you slowly float the balloon, it usually enters the RV because blood flowing there. But in this situation, to put the catheter in the RV, you should not push fast. If you keep pushing very fast, for example, if you do the swan gets placement in the ICU, you don't use a fluoroscopy, so you don't know. You just have to monitor, observe the pressures, right? But if you don't float or but just keep pushing, then sometimes it's just entangled inside of the right atrium. So you have to make sure catheter is free inside the chamber, is floating. If you slowly advance, it naturally just float inside the chamber to the RV. If you keep slowly advance, the catheter is free inside with a balloon, and it usually naturally goes up to the pulmonary artery. So without using the fluoroscopy, as long as you float the balloon without pushing too fast, the catheter naturally go there because of the shape and the blood flowing. If you go from the femoral, sometimes it's difficult without fluoroscopy. Actually, it's not possible usually. So you cannot go from femoral in the ICU because there are too far to go there, and there's a tortuous seat that it's not directly go there. So you have to do some technique. So if you go from femoral vein, you go to RA first, and then naturally it flows to the RV. So that's no difficulties with. But after the RV, when you go to the pulmonary artery, it's difficult. You have to do clockwise rotation and then advance. That's the technique. But you have to remember these RV waveforms. So this RV goes like this. So in the systolic, you have a large positive deflection. In diastolic, you have this kind of negative deflection. So keep in mind to remember the normal pressure. Normal RV pressure is systolic pressure is 15 to 30, diastolic pressure 1 to 8. So these are important to remember, actually. So for example, patient comes in with shortness of breath and bilateral leg swellings. The patient may have congestive heart failure. So patient is referred to you for right heart catheterization. And then you measured RV pressure. Diastolic pressure was 15. And then peak systolic pressure was 45. Then the patient has pulmonary hypertension and increased IV filling pressure. So this, and then when you measure the wedge pressure, it is like a 25. Then patient have a pulmonary venous and arterial hypertension. The pulmonary hypertension could be due to the left heart failure. So it could be group 2 pulmonary hypertension. So you have to interpret these numbers, and you have to be able to clinically apply these numbers to the patient situation. And also very important to remember mean pulmonary artery pressure. So traditionally, mean PA pressure, what's normal mean PA pressure?
I think that Dr. Lee, to cut the diagnosed pulmonary hypertension, it's 20 mean for 20.
Right. The pulmonary society recently, I think, decreased the upper cutoff of the normal PA pressure. They said about 20 in the resting condition. Traditionally, it was 25 in the past, and then 25 to 35 is a mild. 35 to 45 is moderate. 45 or higher was considered severe pulmonary artery hypertension. That's a traditional grading system. So you have to memorize the up-to-date normal PA pressure so that you can communicate with other medical professionals in objective ways. And then, yeah, this waveforms. The normal PA pressure less than 30 systolic and diastolic 4 to 12. So important to memorize the normal PA diastolic is less than 12. So usually PA diastolic sometimes be used as the surrogate of the LV diastolic pressure or pulmonary capillary wedge pressure. So this one actually showed the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure and the LA pressure. So if you simultaneous measure the LA pressure obtained by transseptal catheter, this one, and the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure by right heart cath, there is little time difference. The LA pressure precedes wedge pressure by 40 to 120 milliseconds. And usually it's higher. LA pressure is usually higher in normal condition. That's why if there's any small ASD, there is LA to RA flow, like a shunt. And then when there's a PFO, normally you don't see actually left to at the right to left shunt in normal condition because LA pressure usually higher than RA pressure. So that's why when there is a stroke patient, you do a contrast bubble study. You have to induce the vagal maneuver or coughing that increase the RA pressure. And briefly, they can reverse the pressure gradient from RA to LA. And they can cause right to left shunt. So just remember the LA pressure normally is a little higher than LA pressure. And then, as you say, there is a delay also with the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure and the LA pressure because of the time, it's not directly measured. And then, pulmonary capillary wedge pressure is slightly lower than the LA pressure. Do you have any questions?
No, definitely.
Okay, so there's some when you do right heart cath, it's very important for the right heart catheterization. You have to let the ordering physician know what is the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure. And then also let them know the PA pressure and also cardiac output index. Sometimes pulmonary vascular resistance. Those four or five numbers are important to be recognized and interpreted. So when you actually insert the balloon to the pulmonary artery, usually the balloon flow to most distal reachable position, but it's better to put the balloon tip in the lower lobar area, not upper lower, middle lobe. The lower lobar pulmonary artery branches represent better actual LV EDP or LA pressure. So pulmonary capillary wedge pressure is traditionally used as the surrogate number of LV EDP or LA pressure. So as long as there is no blockage such as mitral stenosis or CTEP for pulmonary embolization. So that's why measuring the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure is important. So we have to be able to make nice waveforms. Sometimes when the catheter is too much wedged in the very distal pulmonary branches, you don't see actually this kind of waveforms, and it showed like a flat waveforms or very blunted waveforms, dampened waveform. That usually it's not correct. It's because the catheter is placed too deep in the small branches, so you have to try to make nice waveforms to correctly reflect the left side pressure. So normal.
I have a question.
Yes.
Sorry. So when we report pulmonary capillary wedge, we talk about if there was a prominent V wave. Does that does that correlate with the severity of MR, or does that just mean you have high LV and diastolic pressure?
Yes, that's actually, we talk about so the V-wave is a ventricular contraction, and then most of the time the V-wave, if you have large V-wave, that's considered mitral regurgitation. But it is not always very correctly reflect the mitral regurgitation. Sometimes even severe MR, you may not see actually a V wave, depending on the balloon position and then condition of the lungs. So if there is any large V wave, there is a possibility of a severe mitral regurgitation. But even though you don't see a large V wave, you cannot rule out there is no severe mitral regurgitation, because it doesn't always correlate one to one. I think probably there is some mention about that in the later phase. I cannot find it now. But if you see large V-wave, you can think about possible severe mitral regurgitation, but it doesn't always correlate the severity.
Okay,
thank you.
Actually, Dr. Lee, I have another question about measuring pulmonary capillary wedge pressure. Uh-huh. Specifically at bedside, when patient has a swan in, a PA catheter in, and the balloon is up, the tracings are never clean. There is a lot of like respiratory variation up and down, and on top of that respiratory variation, there is a, you know, ACV waves in X and Y. So so I mean, it gets in real time, which, I mean, I know we take the end expiratory, you know, in theory, but even the end expiratory has like this, the waveforms are like all over. So which part do we take? Which number do we take? Because it's a quite wide range when we look at the waveforms, and it's anywhere between like, say, 18 and 25. So so it makes it a little bit difficult. How do we manage in that kind of bedside,
So if the patient has a, especially if patient is intubated on mechanical ventilation, or if patient in the cath lab sedated, and then patient breathe like a almost like sleep apnea pattern, or the patient has COPD, those patients actually show significant respiratory variation. It's like this way. So in the end expiration, the wedge pressure actually go high. So technically, they recommend use end expiratory pressure, which is higher pressure. And sometimes, as you said, it's difficult to recognize. So we use actually as a mean pressure sometimes.
Okay. So
you can see mean pressure. For example, if it's an ACX VY like M shape,
mm-hmm.
you can, if we do a cath lab, actually the machine shows mean pressure automatically. But if you do in the ICU, if the monitoring does not show you mean pressure, you have to arbitrarily line mean pressure in between ACX VY.
Okay.
So the mean pressure probably more reflect the pressures.
Okay.
So and then use expiratory pressure, not inspiratory pressure.
Okay. Sounds good. Sounds good. So a line through the M, through the middle of the M, so called.
Yeah, middle of the ACX VY.
Yes.
It's usually called like this way.
Yeah.
And then the mean pressure actually, it's not mean of ANV wave. The mean, actually the machine does not calculate the mean pressure by for example, if A wave is 8, VF 12, You don't do 8 plus 12 divided 2. It's not mean pressure. Because the mean pressure is actually a summation of all the ACX VY. Sometimes there is a lot of negative deflection. So mean pressure is not A plus V divided by 2. It's a combination ACX VY including negative pressure. So some people actually, pulmonologists ask, why mean pressure is not A plus V divided 2? They sometimes ask us specifically. Okay. And then, so it's also important to recognize the LVEDP. So LVEDP is measured by the left heart catheterization. LVEDP cannot be measured by right heart cath directly, but you can assume the LVEDP by measuring the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure by only right heart cath. But if you have to know LVEDP, you have to order left heart catheterization. The left heart catheterization does not mean you have to do coronary angiography technically. Coronary angiography is a different procedure. So left heart catheterization, you have to insert catheter in the left ventricle, right? So you have to insert catheter in the left ventricle. So you have to cross the aortic valve. And then you can see here, the left ventricle and the diastolic filling pressure is indicated of health of LV. So if LV, left ventricle is healthy, LVEDP normal. If it's not healthy, LVEDP is increased. Sometimes if the patient is dehydrated, LVEDP is very low. I see sometimes patients come to the cath lab after NPO for like 12 hours, LVEDP almost like zero. Some people who has heart failure or acute MI, patient LVEDP is 25. So it's important to recognize number. So also when you see these waveforms, it's important to recognize this LVEDP right there. So it's coincident with the R wave on the EKG. So LVEDP immediately precedes the beginning of the isovolumetric ventricular contraction of the left ventricle. So the isovolumetric ventricular contraction starts right there. LVEDP is right just before the uprising. Usually it's there's a little A wave there, little notch there. So you have to recognize little notch like this one. And then if you compare it with the EKG, it's just at R wave here. So some people actually has two notch here, like one here, one here. So you have to actually compare with the R wave. So you have to be able to recognize in real time when this waveform flowing in the cath lab monitor. So you have to immediately recognize the LVEDP. That's why when you record this in real time, you have to ask the people to control these waveforms, increase the size and speed, and then you can recognize this waveform better. Because normally you see this one is 200 scale. In that case, you cannot recognize this one. So you have to make this one like a 25 millimeter scale so that you can see this in larger waveforms. So anyway, normal LVEDP is 12 or less than 12. This is very important to remember, 12. We'll talk about this in the next time. And then LV gram actually, or left heart catheterization, is not always necessary. For example, if you order left heart cath for coronary angiography, actually you don't order left heart cath for coronary angiography for evaluation of the coronary artery disease. You have to order coronary angiography. That's a different code. You have to order coronary angiography. And then if you want to know LV EDP or left ventricular function by LV gram, you have to order left heart catheterization. So you have to order coronary angiography with left heart cath. That's actual order. If we want to see NSTEMI patient or coronary artery disease patient. But if you just want to do for valvular heart disease or constitutive pericarditis, you want to just want to do LV RV tracing or other cardiac hemodynamics to differentiate if the patient has constitutive pericarditis, you don't need to always order coronary angiography. You can order left and right heart cath. In that case, I or some other interventionalist or people may not do coronary angiography actually. So that's why you have to use correct order. But anyway, if we want to place the catheter in the LV, sometimes this one is not easy when you do in your catheter rotation. So the other things, catheter placement in the LV sometimes cause complication. Rarely, but it actually can happen. So you always have to think about if you have to do left heart cath, if you just feel enough to coronary angiography only. So if you do left heart, what I'm saying is left heart cath is not always mandatory to do when you want to know coronary anatomy. So when you do left heart cath, usually if you keep pushing, it actually bend like this, and usually it stretch this area, and then it will open up the valve a little bigger, and then when you pull back, it actually jump down to the LV. But sometimes you can do with wire. So there are two techniques depending on the techniques, I mean the interventionist. But anyway, you should not do too aggressively. Some people has a lot of calcification here in this area. Usually atherosclerosis not much here in this sinus valsava. Atherosclerosis actually here in the upper ascending aorta or arch. So less manipulation in this area is better. So you should not do too aggressive catheter manipulation in the upper area here, or even in this area when there is a fluoroscopy showing a calcification in this area. You don't know if the patient has a mitral stenosis or not, and you don't have echo then, but you have a lot of calcification here, then the catheter is not going easily, then you don't do too much aggressiveness, then it's safer to the patient. And anyway, if the catheter is introduced LV, you can measure LV pressure. There are several catheter. There's a little straight catheter and then angled catheter. There's a hole here and a side hole here. So this angled catheter actually is easier to integrate into the LV than the straight catheter. And there is a 5 or 6 French catheters. And the purpose of the left heart catheterization is actually to measure LV EDP and also to do left ventriculogram. So when there is no echo, left ventriculogram is important to recognize the wall motion abnormality in the ACS condition. So sometimes when patient come to the emergency room and the EKG was not certain which artery is culprit for ACS or STEMI, then sometimes people do LV gram first. If there is a wall motion abnormality here, that LAD may be the culprit. If wall motion abnormality here, maybe RCA is culprit. If wall motion is abnormal in this area, maybe circumflex is culprit. So usually you do RA 30 degree. So it's actually incorrect. It's LAO, it's not RAO. This is LA of you. So if you do LA of 30, you can see the anterior wall and then inferior wall and apex. So this territory usually
Dr. Lee.
Yes.
I thought the picture on the left is RAO.
Yeah.
And the one on the right is LAO.
Because that's correct. Yeah, that's correct. I was confused. This is RAO. This is LAO. This is correct, actually. So this is RAO.
Yeah. Thanks for the clarification. Yeah.
It's clear. Yeah, thank you. So in the RAO, this is the LAD territory. This is the apex. So most of the time, if apex is not moving, that's LAD disease. And if LAD moving, but I mean the apex is moving, but with anterior lateral here is not moving, then which artery is culprit?
Diagonal?
Yeah, diagonal. Usually diagonal. Diagonal usually induce wall motion abnormality in this area. But if LAD, proximal LAD closed, we have to, the patient usually have wall motion abnormality from here all the way up, all the way down, apex and up to this level usually. If LAD is very long and wrap around here, we will have wall motion up to this level, like hold this area. And then if RCA is the culprit for ACS, you see wall motion actually posterior basal area or up to mid diaphragm this area, depending on the RCA size. And then also, if you do LV gram in the RAO, you will see this aorta like this. And then there is a mitral valve area here, LT valve here. So if there is any significant mitral regurgitation, you will see something blushing here in this area. This is LA left atrial area. So the purpose of the LV gram is also to measure the mitral valve regurgitation. If your interest is to grade mitral regurgitation, you have to do LV gram with RAO view to see something coming from LV to LA this way. And then if you want to see the wall motion abnormality in the lateral wall or posterior lateral wall, when the culprit of stemi or stemi is the left circumflex artery, you have to do LAO 60. So usually this area will not move. And then this actually is the septal area. So if your culprit artery is circumflex, do LAO view as well. This is not routinely performed because it requires additional contrast amount. But sometimes if you have to do, you have to do. And then also, this is more technical things, but you probably have to know if you do actually catheterization yourself as attending, you have to know how much you inject, how fast you inject. You inject actually with manual injection with your hand power, but that only inject like 10 cc, right? And then most of the time, 10 cc is not enough to opacify this whole left ventricle. And then usually the power is not enough. So that's why if you want to make this good image, you have to use a power injector, like machine injector. And then usually you inject total about at least 35 to 40, sometimes at least 30 to 40 cc, and then 10 to 15 cc per second. And then also depending on the catheter size, you have to decide the PSI, the pressure, usually 5 French 600 and 900, and 6 French is 600 PSI. But usually you may not need to remember for the board examination. They will not ask these technical things, but you have to remember these things: anterior lateral, apical, posterior basal. This is important to recognize. This is the septal, this is the lateral wall. And if you want to see mitral regurgitation, you have to see this area. It's important to know. And then, let's just see. Okay. So the complication of ventriculography is not common, very rare. And so I didn't say about complication of right heart cath actually, but the complication of right heart cath is not very common. There's not much actually complication. Only there is a possible complication of right heart cath when you touch the AB AB group area, when the catheter actually sits placed in the pulmonary artery. Sometimes the catheter touch the AB group area, and then can cause AB block transiently. If patient already have a left boundary branch block, there is a very small risk of actually transient complete heart block from right heart cath. Also, patient can develop some kind of catheter-induced tachycardia, like atrial tachycardia. But that's usually transient. When the catheter is removed, patient is fine. The rhythm goes back to normal. But the ventriculography has a little higher risk of complication compared to right heart cath because the catheter is in the arterial system and it cross the aortic valve, and it aggressively touch the aorta sometimes in a difficult condition. So first, most important thing is you can actually induce a stroke. That's why, for example, if there is any severe aortic stenosis, and you are going to do coronary angiography before the aortic valve replacement. And if the echo shows certainly diagnostically severe AS, you don't always need to cross aortic valve again because there is small risk of embolization. That's why, but if you have a discrepancy between the echo and patient's symptom looks severe, and you have to know if the aortic valve is severe or not so that you can send the patient to surgery, then you have to cross the aortic valve. So that's why you have to think about if you have to do LV catheter placement or not in every situation. Because I saw one case actually ventricular perforation, not from our hospital, but other hospital I saw, they placed the catheter and the wire actually perforates the ventricle, caused VSD. That happened, I saw it actually, and then sometimes if the catheter tip is situated in the some kind of trabecula or it's stuck somewhere, and then you inject with the power injector, you can actually cause significant myocardial blushing. Usually that's not causing perforation, but it looks very ugly in the ventriculography picture. So you have to very careful. You have to make sure catheter is in free condition. Sometimes catheter actually is cut in the mitral valve apparatus, like a chorda or papillary muscle or somewhere. And then if you inject forcefully there, you actually will make a mitral regurgitation severely. That make the diagnosis very confused. That's why catheter need to be free in the cavity center, usually in the mid LV. If catheter is too distal at the apex, because the injector gives significant power in the muscle, you will the patient actually will, the LV will develop severe PVC during injection, and then you cannot use that to measure correct LV function or wall motion because it's technically causing VT transiently. So LV wall motion is not correct. That's why we have to do carefully. And then another purpose of the LV gram is to measure LV EDP actually. So you can use the program in the catheter machine. You can trace this end diastolic and end systolic LV gram, and then you can make ejection fraction. Those are also important. And then when the catheter actually placed in the aorta, you will measure the aorta pressure. So we discussed the aorta pressure, central aorta pressure, and the femoral artery pressure is not the same, and the time doesn't happen at the same time. These are important when you do aortic valve stenosis, as I said, because there's time discrepancy. So you cannot use femoral artery pressure and LV pressure to measure aortic valve pressure gradient. So that's why you have to do single catheter technique with dual lumen. So you can make this together with one catheter. It's called Langston catheter. You insert the pigtail catheter has a side hole. Inside there are two lumens. You can transfer the pressure from tip and then in the proximal pole. So you, in the proximal pole, you will measure central aortic pressure. And then from the tip pressure, you can measure LV pressure. So in normal condition, because it's technically very close to each other, you can make very simultaneous pressure. And then we can see the pressure gradient. We'll discuss the abnormal pressure waveforms, but normally this pressure is very similar when you use a dual lumen single catheter. The LV pressure, aorta pressure, very similar in the peak pressure. And then the peak systolic pressure time is usually very instantaneous, very similar in normal condition. And then depending on the myocardial condition, sometimes you do this dual lumen right left heart cath together. You see this one is RV tracing from the right heart cath. The catheter is in the vein and it's located in the RV. And another catheter from the artery and it's located in the LV. So you simultaneously measure. So the panel A show normal patient who has a junctional rhythm. And then usually in diastolic, diastolic pressure in normal patient is normal and usually it's equal. So the bad LV or RV condition is the higher the pressure. So if diastolic pressure higher goes high, then that means LV, RV filling pressure is high and it's not normal. So in panel B, there is a elevated LV diastolic pressure. This patient may have a some almost an abnormality or relaxation abnormality. Something LV pressure is higher than RV pressure. And the panel C, also this patient LV pressure is very high. But in panel D, this LV pressure is very high, RV pressure also high here. But this patient has biventricular dysfunction. That's why if the LV EDP, RV EDP very close to zero, less than 12, and then similar, that's normal, near normal. But if we're going higher, higher, or it's higher equalization, that's abnormal. Some patient has actually some kind of a negative diffraction and flattening. Something like that is a constrictive pericarditis. LV, IV pressure equally elevated also in those conditions. So whenever you have a diastolic pressure, LV, IV pressure high in this area, that condition is considered LV or RV dysfunction. There are different pathology, of course, for the condition, but diastolic pressure is important to recognize. For example, if you do LV-IV tracing together, especially in the constrictive pericarditis, there's a increased respiratory variation in this situation. So you can see actually in the end expression, the RV pressure decrease. So you have increased pressure gradient here. So this respiratory variation is called this concordancy of the LV-IV systolic pressure due to the enhancement of the ventricular interdependence. So respiratory expiratory depression of RV pressure make this area increased. So you can have a something like this also. But in restricted physiology, it actually go together. LV-IV go together. But in the constrictive pericarditis, LV-IV is more separate interdependence. So the peak systolic pressure become interdependent. So in the end expression, IV peak systolic pressure down. And then maybe slight elevation of the LV pressure, and this area enlarged. It's like a respiratory variation. I think we talk about this LA pressure, which pressure, if you measure together, LA pressure comes first, which pressure a little later, LA pressure a little higher than the primary cup rate pressure. Waveforms are very similar. So sometimes pulmonary capillary wedge pressure does not correctly represent LA pressure, then you have to puncture the septum to meticulously measure pressure of the LA. And if you see the large V wave in the wedge pressure waveform, there is a possibility of the mitral, significant mitral valve regurgitation. Because when the mitral regurgitation happens, the blood shoot to the pulmonary vein, and then that is measured by the wedge pressure. So also, it depends on the location of the direction of the wedge pressure. If you actually have a eccentric mitral jet toward to the left side of the pulmonary vein, and then your wedge pressure tip actually in the right side, then may at that time that may not show actually a large V wave. Because it's not directly there in the geometry. So that's why if the large V wave shown, then there's a mitral regurgitation severely probably. But even though there's no large V wave, but echo shows severe regurgitation, then echo is correct, even though there's no large wave in the pulmonary cup bridge pressure waveforms. Do you understand? Do you have any questions?
Yeah, understand, Dr. Lee.
Yeah. So today, I think I'm just finishing here. We'll probably discuss the pathology, like valvular disease, in the next time if you want. So my summary is to memorize normal waveforms and normal numbers. So these are normal numbers. You have to memorize this one in your brain. And also, I didn't talk about the other thing, cardiac output or pulmonary vascular resistance or shunt fraction, those things we can discuss in the next time. And the pathology. Also, I didn't discuss about the hemodynamics of the valvular disorders.
We can do them maybe next month. I'll email you, Dr. Lee.
Yeah. So, do you have any other questions for normal condition, normal hemodynamics?
Doesn't seem to be any questions, Dr. Lee.
Okay.
Great. Oh, thank you so much. Thank you very much.
Okay.
Thank you, Dr. Lee.
Okay. Bye-bye.